Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item C in private. Are we agreed? Thank you. So our next item is an evidence session with the Fair Work Convention. Last year, the Fair Work Convention published a research report that benchmarked Scotland's progress on a series of fair work indicators against similar countries. And the purpose of the session is to provide the committee with an opportunity to discuss the report and its implications. If I first just myself make a declaration of interest, that I am a member of Unite the Union.
Convener, I'm a member of Unison, which appears in my declaration of interest.
Thank you. Lorna?
Thank you, Convener.
Lorna Slater.
Thank you, Convener. I'm also a member of Unite the Union.
Thank you. And Colin Smith, did you wish to come in?
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I declare interest as a member of Unite the Union and the GMB as well?
Thank you. So I welcome Professor Patricia Finlay, the co-chair of the Fair Work Convention, and Helen Martin, the head of the Fair Work Convention Secretariat. Thank you for joining us this morning. This year, you've published the benchmarking report, which looks to compare the work in Scotland across comparable countries. Could you maybe summarise the kind of key findings from the report in terms of reflecting on progress that has been made in Scotland? And there will be an opportunity to go more in depth to the report with other questions, but if you maybe summarise what the headlines of the report has told us about progress in Scotland.
Okay, maybe I will start just by doing a very brief introduction on the convention. I might ask Helen to pick up on some of the findings of the report, and I'm happy to come back on questions. You'll be aware that the convention was established in 2015 by the Scottish Government. Following a key recommendation of the Working Together Review, we are independent of government. We have 10 members drawn from industry, from trade unions and with an academic advisor. I am co-chair of the convention alongside Mary Alexander, Deputy Regional Secretary of Unite the Union. Convention members provide all of their expertise, insight and their time pro bono, so nobody in the convention is remunerated, but the convention is a group of people really committed to fair work in Scotland and to delivering measurable progress in the indicators of fair work that we've outlined. And that's the reason why we commissioned some research to look at where we were. The convention had published a report in 2020, which was our first measurement framework, to get a sense of a benchmark following the publication of the Fair Work Framework in 2015. And then we updated that report recently by commissioning research from Alma Economics, an independent research consultancy. And following that, we've made our own submissions and recommendations to the Scottish Government based on those findings. And it might make sense if Helen talks us through some of the findings and we can pick up on issues which are of interest to committee members.
Yes, so if I start with the Fair Work Measurement Framework, which was refreshed within the research, it found that of the 45 indicators, 19 had improved, 10 had worsened, and 14 had fluctuated or remained broadly stable. And there was within that some areas that were quite positive. So the report noted that there had been a significant decrease in the proportions of employees earning less than the real living wage, which now sits at 9% in 2022, this is, that the gender pay gap had almost halved from 6.4% to 3.7% in 2022, that involuntary self-employment had fallen from 3.7% in 2016 to 2% in 2022, and the ethnicity employment gap had fallen from 16.3 percentage points in 2016 to 11.7 percentage points in 2021, while the ethnicity pay gap had declined slightly from 7.5% in 2016 to 5.9% in 2021. So there were in the report some positive findings that we were able to identify, but there was also quite a lot that was, had moved in the wrong direction, and that we'd really noticed that between 2016 and 2021, self-reported stress, depression or anxiety caused or made worse by work had more than doubled, that the percentage of employers who provided training to their employees had fallen from 73% in 2017 to 70% in 2021, that access to flexible working had improved slightly, but that actually around 3/4 of workers still had no access to flexible working, that the disability pay gap had increased from 13.7% in 2016 to 18.5% in 2021, and the use of zero hours contracts had increased from 2.2% in 2016 to 3.4% in 2022. And I think we find that zero hours contract element quite, you know, quite disappointing, really, because that had been a key element of focus for the Scottish Government and had been included within things like Fair Work First. So it was very positive to see the movement on the real living wage, which the government had put a lot of focus on, and there had been a lot of sort of emphasis on that area, but it hadn't necessarily fed through every element that they put emphasis on. And, you know, that we were concerned about some of those findings. Within the same report, we also developed the International Fair Work Nation framework. And the idea here was to help us answer the question of what does it mean to be a leading fair work nation. So it was about trying to benchmark Scotland's performance against a range of countries that were already doing well across a range of indicators. So we did pick countries that had a good story to tell in that respect. And what we did was we took indicators from the Fair Work Measurement Framework, and we compared them at an international level. Now, the indicators were chosen primarily on the basis of data comparability. So for that reason, there were lots of indicators that existed in the domestic framework that were not able to be compared internationally because the data quality just wasn't there. But the framework benchmarks Scotland's performance against Denmark, Belgium, Austria, Finland, Iceland, Ireland, the Netherlands and England. And the comparator countries were chosen because they offered a stretching but realistic benchmark for Scotland. And they incorporated a range of countries that are similar size with a similar GDP where comparable data is available. The framework includes 14 indicators, of which 13 were drawn from the Fair Work Measurement Framework, and one low pay is unique to the International Fair Work Nation Framework. And the reason why we did that was because we felt that it was important to have a measure of pay, but that it is actually quite difficult to compare wages directly, and that often at an international level, this is the indicator that is used to compare performance. And what we find was that across that no country leads on all indicators, but there are a range of countries who are doing better across a range of indicators as Scotland, and that we felt that to measure fair work, you couldn't measure a single indicator, that you did need to be doing well across a range of indicators. We did find areas where Scotland's performance was comparatively positive. So on permanent employment rates, for example, Scotland was first place out of 9th in the framework. On youth unemployment, it was 2nd out of 9th, with a 0.9 percentage point gap to the leading Fair Work Nation. And on work-related ill health and disease, it was 2nd out of 9th with a 1.8 percentage point gap to the leading Fair Work Nation. It was mid-table on a range of indicators as well. So the gender economic inactivity gap, it was 4th out of 9th. The gender pay gap, it was 4th out of 9th. Workplace non-fatal injuries, it was 5th out of 9th. And low pay, it was 5th out of 8th, because that's just about data availability. Trade union membership, 5th out of 9th. Underemployment, 6th out of 9th. And involuntary part-time work was 6th out of 9th. There were a range of comparatively poor performance indicators. The disability employment gap was 6th out of 8th, with a 23.2 percentage point gap between it and the leading Fair Work Nation. Involuntary non-permanent work was 7th out of 9th, with a 25 percentage point gap. Collective bargaining, 7th out of 9th, with a 59.9 percentage point gap. And skills underutilisations was 8th out of 8th, with a 20.6 percentage point gap. So I think what we noted here was that, yes, we were doing well on some indicators like permanent employment, but even there we noted that actually on the indicators of involuntary in secure work, we were doing very poorly. So that was telling a kind of story of the labour market in Scotland in itself. And that, you know, when you were in a, there were a lot of people in permanent work, which was good, but there was quite a lot of people in insecure work that they did not want to be in. And the penalty of that seems to be quite high. We also find...
Other members will pick up on particular areas. That's a really helpful overview of some of the key indicators. Before I bring in Colin Smith, I don't know if you want to maybe say a wee bit more about the disability employment gap. If it's, that is an inquiry the committee have just undertaken, and we're getting near to publishing a report, but it's an area we have interest in. And as you pointed out, Scotland is 6 out of 8. Now, you earlier said, I think, in terms of living wage, that there, we had seen really good progress in Scotland, and part of that was down to the government's focus on it, and they really kind of targeted improvements in that. Is that other countries who are doing better in terms of disability employment gap, is it because of government direction that's achieving that, and do you think we need to see more activity from the government? I know we're making some progress there, but there's concerns to fill the, to meet the gap. There's still quite a lot to do. What do you think? Do you have a view on what the government needs to do here and why our gap is... where we're sitting at 6 out of 8.
One of the advantages of the real living wage as an indicator of fair work is it's a single measure. So it's relatively more straightforward to focus on how a single measure might be supported and implemented in a variety of different contexts. The disability employment gap is more complex in the sense that there's a more complex interplay of factors that relate to whether or not people who have a disability are in employment. But I think where we see a difference in the international framework is in countries where there is strong support for active labour market policy that supports people in training and into work. So training, employability and support at work. So the leading example for the disability employment gap is Denmark, which has the lowest disability employment gap. Denmark, as I'm sure the committee will be aware, is a more social market economy rather than a liberal market economy. It's more coordinated in terms of how employers and employees and government work together to deliver outcomes. And so part of that, part of those institutional structures and investment in active labour market policies are the reasons why the disability employment gap is so low. But I think it is also worth pointing out the really significant role of employers here. If we look across the UK at the rate of the disability employment gap, we realise that it changes rather a lot in the context of local labour market conditions. So if you're in the southeast of England, where the labour market has been tighter traditionally, then the willingness of employers to make adjustments to either keep people with a disability in employment or bring people with disabilities into employment appears to be higher. So we see lower gaps across the UK. And I think in part it's to do with different institutional structures in other countries, and in part it's to do with employer behaviour in response to the relative tightness or otherwise of labour markets.
Thank you. I'll bring in Colin Smith to be followed by Lorna Slater.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. We're about to see probably the single biggest step forward in workers' rights in a generation through the UK government's employment bill, a ban on those zero-hour contracts you mentioned, Helen, action on fire and rehire, day one rights around parental leave, sick pay, and so on. And crucially, that's across the UK, so we won't see a race to the bottom in one side of the border. But given these changes that are coming forward, I'm interested to know what you now think, I suppose, our focus should be in relation to devolved competencies to add value to those changes that are coming. What should our focus be in relation to what is effectively Scottish Government policy?
The member's talking about the proposals outlined in the New Deal for Working People, and those proposals are out there. We don't have much detail about how they're going to be implemented. I think it's undoubtedly the Convention's position that these provide a useful statutory basis for underpinning fair work in Scotland and across the UK, and the Convention supports many of the proposals that are contained in that New Deal for Working People. They are very consistent with the kinds of things that the Fair Work Framework has focused on for the last 8 or 9 years, and in fact I think point to the correct decision to focus on some of these areas in a devolved context when there was no statutory underpinning. So that will be very important, and it will mean that some things, the ones you've mentioned, banning of zero-hours contracts, the prohibition of fire and rehire, can maybe be removed from the kinds of things that we are perhaps interested in and are included within the Fair Work First conditionality framework. But there are some big... So there's still some detail about what those proposals look like. There's a huge issue around enforcement. One of the things that we know about statutory rights is that you may have them, but they may not be particularly well enforced. So there is some discussion in the New Deal proposals of a single enforcement agency. But one big challenge will be where areas of enforcement cross with devolved power. So it may be that there's a need for a very constructive conversation across Scottish and UK policymakers about not just the detail of those proposals, and I think Scotland has a very important role to play in discussing how those proposals can be designed and delivered and implemented in the best way based on the experience that we've had of Fair Work, but also what that means for areas where there are devolved powers that may well have relevance to issues of enforcement. So I think that's really quite important. I think it's also the case that one of the things that statutory implementation does, which is very good, is it provides a very effective floor of rights. So it provides important minima. Some of the areas that have been proposed, for example, rights to trade union access and support for sectoral agreements, are really crucially important to trying to improve dialogue and social dialogue in Scotland and in the rest of the UK. So that underpinning of rights is incredibly important. But there are also some areas where we need to build both relationships and capacity that allow those rights and that dialogue to be effectively delivered. And so I think there are still some role for policymakers in Scotland, notwithstanding an improved statutory framework, to be creating the kinds of conditions and relationship and information and advice that encourages employers and unions and other employee organisations to have constructive conversations about the very many challenges that they face. So I think the convention very much welcomes what we've seen so far in terms of that plan. It will remove some of the emphasis on Fair Work that we've focused on in previous years. But I think there's a lot of learning both ways in terms of how we embed the kind of approach and dialogue that allows you to deliver effectively on statutory rights.
That's very, very helpful indeed. Patricia, you mentioned the issue around sectoral agreements, and this has obviously been an important priority for the Fair Work Convention, encouraging those particular agreements. I mean, given the fact we may see that strengthened from a statutory point of view, what evidence do we have that those sectoral agreements have so far been successful in their implementation? Presumably because they're also voluntary, makes that challenging at the moment. But is there evidence that is a real direction of travel that we should be, first of all, encouraging from a devolved point of view, but actually ultimately across the UK putting a statutory back into them?
One of the things that we see if we look at international evidence is a relatively strong association, not a complete one, but a relatively strong association between the presence of collective bargaining and the delivery of a variety of the types of practices that we have defined as being important for Fair Work here in Scotland. So we tend to see lower rates of inequality. We tend to see better rates of pay. So the presence of collective bargaining is associated internationally with some pretty good outcomes. We know from the work that we've done, so our second sector inquiry was into construction, which we reported on a couple of years ago. We know that sector-based arrangements can work very well because they prohibit a race to the bottom. If you look at things like the NACE agreement in construction that Select operate, that encourages independent electrical contractors to sign up to a set of membership and terms and conditions that means that they compete on other things than a race that takes labour rights and labour rewards to the bottom. And those agreements work very well. They are supported by employers, they are supported by unions, and they deliver good outcomes for workers. So we have evidence that sectoral bargaining in a number of different ways work well. In our own social care inquiry, we have one of the things that was very clear was not only that workers didn't feel that they had much of a voice in the sector at all across the range of providers, but specifically in the private and third sector, but that employers also didn't think that they had a place where they could have a collective voice. And so our support for a sectoral agreement in social care was to provide that voice and that place, harking back to the previous question, that place for social dialogue to emerge, where some of the real challenges in social care or in construction or other sectors can be addressed by the people who know most about them. And that's not policymakers, and it's not politicians, and it's not the Fair Work Convention. It's people on the ground. So the advantage of sectoral bargaining is it provides a place for that dialogue. And I think that's where we see real benefits in how people learn to engage in effective social dialogue.
Okay, that's really helpful, Patricia. Well, my final question, you touched on a lot of points that I was going to come back on, but I suppose my final question is just around low pay. Again, we're likely to see changes, and we're already seeing changes from the UK government that aim to make the minimum wage effectively a genuine living wage. Now, given that earlier, Helen, you mentioned that we're already seeing progress in Scotland. We've got an increase in the number of employers paying the real living wage. I think we've got the highest proportion across the UK. I mean, how do you respond to those who say, well, that change from the UK government isn't necessary, we're actually already making progress and working with employers is the way ahead, not increasing that from a statutory point of view? How do you respond to those suggestions?
From the discussions of the Low Pay Commission, it does look like, and this isn't a finalised figure, but it does look like that the figure for the national living wage, taking into account cost of living, which they are now being encouraged by the government to do, is going to be around £12.10. So it's not that far away from the real... I might have got that the wrong way around. The national living wage will be £12.10, so £10 more than the current real living wage, although the real living wage will adapt. I think there will still be a role for the real living wage depending on how earnings growth impacts on the national minimum wage, although the gap between those things may reduce over time. It is the case that I think the Labour government proposals are to try to remove the national living wage, to make the application of that to 18 and above. There's currently an age bar, but they would not change 18 and below, and they would not change the rate for apprentices. You'll know that we've advocated in Scotland for apprentices to be paid the real living wage for a whole host of different reasons. So there will still be areas, I think, in which that difference between the real living wage and the national living wage is significant, and they will address different areas of concern within the labour market. But arguing for an improved real living wage on a statutory basis does extend the coverage of that far more significantly than relying on a voluntary real living wage. And we saw that from the implementation of the national minimum wage decades ago. Huge concerns about the fact that that legislation would cause problems for employers, that it would destroy jobs. But in actual fact, all of the evidence is that it has done neither of those things. And in fact, it has not only increased earnings, it has reduced significantly the gender pay gap, because women were amongst the groups that were most likely to be low paid. So I don't, as an academic and as chair of the convention, don't feel terribly concerned that there will be negative outcomes of a better statutory underpinning for minimum wages in the UK.
Can I add one point to that? So we actually speak to a lot of employers, and we've recently done a hospitality inquiry where we spoke to a lot of employers in that sector who, you know, often pay below the real living wage. And I think from speaking to them, the sense that I got was that actually putting in a higher statutory underpinning would be actually very helpful here, because it means that the sort of playing field is quite level between employers, and it kind of makes it less of a sort of risk for an employer who is trying to raise the wages and do the right thing for their employees, because everyone is having to do that. So there are benefits in taking a statutory approach here. as I think Tricia was outlining.
Yeah. And I think that comes across from lots of employers, that one of the challenges of people who have signed up to Real Living Wage accreditations, particularly in low value added sectors. So when you're talking about retailing, hospitality, catering, facilities management, employers, many of whom have signed up to the Real Living Wage in those sectors, do feel disadvantaged and do report that they would just prefer if everybody had to pay the same wage as them. They're committed in a value sense to the Real Living Wage for their employees, but they would like not to be disadvantaged by that in competitive terms.
Lorna Slater, followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Colin has highlighted very well what one of the examples of powers that are reserved that are not part of the devolved settlement here. I'll pick into another one, Helen. You raised the matter, and I'm worried as well from what I see that 0 hours contracts are significantly up from 2016. So I'd like to hear from you, why is that? Why are 0 hours contracts a problem? And what can be done? I mean, it would be useful to know what can be done in a devolved sense, because we're here to hold the Scottish Government to account. But it is also sometimes useful to know what is reserved.
Yes, we can see that 0 hours contracts have risen. The research doesn't tell us why, but we have recently done the hospitality inquiry, as I say, and that sector is a big user of 0 hours contracts. A third of all 0 hours contracts in Scotland are within the hospitality sector. And certainly one of the trends that we observed while doing that inquiry was that there had been quite a pressure on, a competition for staff. There'd been a real pressure to attract staff into the industry, and that had made wages rise sort of under market forces amongst that industry. And a bit of a trade-off for that seemed to be the greater use of 0 hours contracts. So it was a way of making that more affordable for the employer, and of reducing the risk of bringing someone on by using the 0 hour contract. So that seemed to be something of a trend within that sector, and may account for some of the rise over time, but there are probably other reasons.
Yeah, I think that's correct. I think there are different reasons for the rise in other sectors. I think what it's important to focus on is, and it's a rise from a relatively small base, but the experience of those contracts are often very negative for workers. They can provide forms of flexibility for employers, although there may well be some hidden drawbacks in those, but they are really problematic for workers. And I don't think we need to think very much about evidence for that, although there is quite a lot of it. We need to think about what it would be like not to know what our income was week to week or month to month. It doesn't make for effective planning. It doesn't allow for a stable family life, and it certainly doesn't allow you to plan for the future. So 0 hours contracts can be extremely problematic. And it's important to work out that lots of organisations who previously used 0 hours contracts, my own sector, the HE sector, used to be quite a big user of 0 hours contracts, have very successfully moved away from them. Employers can deliver forms of contractual flexibility that offer some security, which is a key dimension of fair work, without resorting to a 0 hours contract. It's not the only way in which flexibility can be delivered. As Helen said in the hospitality inquiry, we did see some employers who thought it was entirely required by their business model to use 0 hours contract because of fluctuating demand, because things happen, people cancel orders at the last minute, that you don't know what your demand will be in any particular weekend in a hospitality venue. But we also saw employers who were very, very committed to not using 0 hours contracts because they didn't feel it was an appropriate way to engage with their staff. And for staff themselves, while there were some who said, well, it may help if I'm a student and therefore I can have access to shifts when I want them and not when I don't want them, for other people who were in the sector more long term, those contracts were really, really difficult.
Thank you. I should probably disclose my husband worked on a 0 hour contract for several years, so I'm aware of the sharp end of that as well. Thank you very much for that one. My next question also slightly relates to this barrier between reserved and devolved powers. Comparing with other countries on that list, how do the UK and Scotland compare in childcare provision, and how much do we think that affects the data?
We know that if you look at the sort of ranking of childcare provision, then we find that countries like the Nordics and Iceland tend to be at the top end of that, and that we know that that's inextricably connected not just to whether or not women are economically active, but also to the degree of to the nature of their participation, so whether or not they can to the prevalence of things like occupational segregation. So there does seem to be a relationship. We've become very interested, I think, in what we can learn from other systems of childcare. One of the outcomes of the measurement report and part of a recommendation to the Scottish Government was to ask for a bit more of an investigation into that, precisely that relationship between the availability and type of childcare and what that meant for women's labour market participation in particular. In Scotland, we've tended to see early years investment, quite rightly in many ways, as an educational and an attainment issue. But actually, it has a very strong connection to the labour market. And coming back to your previous question, it also is important in relation to very flexible forms of work, because the provision of childcare is probably not quite as flexible as the forms of work that exist. So one of the things we're interested in at the moment and working with the Scottish Government on is to look at that relationship between what childcare does as a form of labour market support as opposed to as a form of support for attainment.
Thank you very much. So just to make sure I've understood that, so is the UK have the lowest provision of childcare of all the countries on that list?
No, I don't think so.
No, okay. So it wasn't at the bottom. Because I noticed it's at the bottom when we average it out, England at the bottom of the table. So that was just an interesting comparison of how the Scottish Government is trying to sort of balance that upwards. For my last question, a slight change of topic then. I'm interested in, with relation to the hospitality work that we've done here, but I'm interested in your work as well, about workers in rural areas. So it's highlighted in the hospitality report, the challenges around hospitality workers, particularly when their housing is provided as part of their job. I'm aware from my previous role that that's also a challenge in the agriculture sector. Workers in the agriculture sector are sometimes, and gamekeepers and so on, often housed as part of their work. And certainly when we were looking at putting in place the conditionality on grant funding that the Scottish Government gives and attaching that to the real living wage, the agriculture sector was one that was really struggling with being able to do that. So I would really be interested in hearing what the issues are for rural workers, in particularly in getting paid the living wage and other aspects of fair work. And what are the conditions like now for rural workers, and what can we do to improve them?
So this is an issue that we took quite a lot of evidence on in our hospitality inquiry, because hospitality is obviously a big sector in rural Scotland. And what we actually found was that for hospitality anyway, the wages weren't as low for hospitality workers in rural areas. There was often a need for the employer to raise wages in order to attract workers to come and work within their venue. I think the difficulty, however, was that there was a real shortage of housing, and the employer often felt that they had to create housing for the worker, and this tied housing was creating quite a lot of fair work issues, in that you're more vulnerable then. If you lose your job, you also lose your housing. The employer sets the rate at which you have to pay for that housing, which was often subsidised, I should say, but it was also difficult for the worker because they didn't have much choice. We took quite a lot of evidence from workers who had family but couldn't have their family living with them because the housing weren't able to bring your family into the housing, so they were having to take jobs but leave children, leave spouses in other parts of the country, and that was that just meant that they couldn't stay in it for any significant period of time with that employer. So it had real detrimental impacts on both employers and workers, and neither party were particularly happy with the situation, because the employer spent a lot of money actually investing in that housing. So it wasn't necessarily very good quality housing from the perspective of the worker, in that it limited quite a lot of what they could do. But the employer was investing quite a lot in that in that provision. So I think looking at the issue of rural housing and trying to provide affordable rural housing for low-paid workers is really important within this sector. It would be certainly something that would make it easier for employers to attract in workers, because it really did put a brake on how many people they could attract into the area.
Could I also make one additional point on that, and Helen has begun to make it. Part of the challenge for employers was that if they were investing in tied housing, they couldn't invest in their business. So there are huge challenges facing some hospitality businesses and requiring investment, but that investment was being diverted into the provision of tied housing rather than into investing and making the business a more resilient and competitive phenomena going forward. The housing issue also interacted with real challenges around childcare, availability of childcare and availability of transport in rural Scotland. And so those three issues together, housing, transport and childcare, made it really, really difficult, both for employers and for employees, to be able to make sure that the hospitality industry had the labour that matched its needs. And those are obviously big infrastructure issues which individual employers can't really do a great deal about, but for which some of which had really significant consequences in terms of, particularly in terms of island communities.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. And good morning, both. Can I ask about the question of skills? Because I was very interested to see in the comparison that you did that Scotland comes last out of eight comparator countries in terms of skills underutilisation. Now, I take it from that you mean people who are essentially overqualified for the jobs that they are doing. Now, you would expect in a tight labour market such as we have that we would see a maximisation of skills, but we're not seeing that. So can you explain a little bit about why that situation is arising?
Okay. So there's no one single academically accepted definition of what skills underutilisation is. So sometimes we talk about skills underutilisation as being, for example, graduates in non-graduate work. So you have a supply of graduates, but you don't have the same matching supply of non-graduate work, and people therefore end up in jobs which are not commensurate with their qualifications. The general measure of skills utilisation asks employers and employees to measure whether or not in the conduct of their work they use all of the skills that they have. And so that's a broader measure than just looking, for example, at qualifications match. And one of the challenges we've seen over a number of years in Scotland, and in fairness to Scotland, I think we've been having discussions on skills underutilisation since probably the late 1990s, if my memory serves me correctly. I think I was involved in some of those discussions very early on. So part of that raises issues around not just the experience of the worker, for whom, when we talk about fulfilment as a part of fair work, we understand that being able to deploy your skills and talents is part of what makes work fulfilling and meaningful. So having a job that doesn't use your skills is problematic for workers themselves. But it's also problematic for employers, because actually what you have there is a resource that you're paying for that's not well used. And then if we think more broadly, as a society, we invest very heavily in education and qualifications, but we don't appear to get the rewards from that in terms of things like productivity. And so there are complex reasons why that occurs, but in part it is to do with the design of jobs and the way in which people are managed in more traditionally managed organisations. So jobs can be relatively narrow, people don't have the opportunity to expand those jobs, they don't engage in problem solving to the extent, for example, that we see in some other European nations when we look at data. And that has consequences, I think the evidence suggests that has consequences for both productivity and innovation. So part of the challenge of skills underutilisation is how people's skills are identified and acknowledged, how employers understand that people have skills and how they might be able to put them to good use. And that's partly to do with, as I said, the design of jobs, but it's also to do with the degree of dialogue that takes place within organisations. So it comes back to this idea of dialogue again. There may well be circumstances where I'm pretty sure if I went to my employer and said, I think I could do this much bigger job, or I could do something that's more demanding, they would bite my hand off. And some organisations are very like that. In other forms of organisation, that's not the case, and people feel that they have skills and talents that are not used. And that's a real challenge from a kind of human capital investment point of view.
Okay. So is there any reason why Scotland performs worse then than other countries?
It's not clear. It may be the UK performs worse than other countries comparatively. It may in part be to do with the composition of Scottish jobs relative to UK jobs. So, from the top of my head, I don't know this figure, but we may have a smaller number of knowledge-based jobs. So it may be that those are areas where the composition of our economy means that we have more routine jobs. If you think about the Scottish economy, we have a very high number of good, productive, challenging, highly qualified jobs, but we also have a very high number of relatively low-skill, low-paid jobs. If we look at it by pay, we can see that we have a high number of low-paid jobs and a high number of high-paid jobs and a much smaller middle. So it may in part be that proportion of lower-paid, lower-quality jobs that's driving our higher rate of skills underutilisation. But I think it has a lot to do with the day-to-day realities of workplaces, how people are managed and how they're encouraged to do to be effective in the jobs that they're in.
All right, thank you. Can I change tack a little bit and ask you on a different subject? Because you both referenced the hospitality inquiry that you did. And many of the recommendations from that involve voluntary action from employers. Now, we have seen some regulation changes. So just yesterday, as I'm sure you know, we saw a law that the previous UK government had introduced on passing on tips. That came into effect yesterday. So you know, there's precedent for government bringing in legislation in this area. But much of what you're saying is about around voluntary action from employers. So how confident are you that we'll see employers take up these recommendations as opposed to having to rely upon further regulation?
So it's important to note that we conduct all of our inquiries in the context that we're in. The convention doesn't have a constitutional position. We conduct our inquiries on the basis of the devolved competencies that are currently in play. And that's not to say we don't, in some circumstances, encourage the Scottish Government to engage constructively with the UK Government on a variety of different things. So voluntary employers' voluntary engagement with some of these things is, of course, what it says on the tin. It's voluntary. They're not compelled to do it. We would always argue, and we have from the inception of the convention, that fair work makes excellent business sense. One of the reasons why the hospitality inquiry took place at an opportune time was that the sector was struggling with recruitment. It was having to look at its labour practices because it was struggling to get staff. And therefore, attraction and retention, getting the best quality staff, encouraging your staff to give of their best, all of those things are supported by Fair Work. So it's a source of occasional irritation to me that when we talk about Fair Work, we're often talking about amelioration of the worst parts of the labour market. And that's really important. We should be trying to ameliorate those people who are having the worst experience. But quite a lot of what drives my passion and inspiration for Fair Work is it allows you to build brilliant businesses. It allows you to be creative and resilient and agile. It allows you to be innovative. It allows you to get the best out of your people. So I think a lot of employers get that. I work with brilliant employers in my day job as an academic every day in Scotland. We have great employers who do great things. And statutory underpinning helps with some of those things, but statutory underpinning won't deliver the day-to-day relationships that allow you to build a great business. And I think that's where the discussion about more constructive social dialogue within workplaces and beyond is really helpful. So some of those employers, I think, in hospitality, and I'll ask Helen to come in since she was part of that inquiry, some of those employers are very keen to take up some of the recommendations. What was very clear from the work that we did, some of which my own research team did, what was clear from that work was that they wanted the solutions to be things that they were agreed with them and not imposed on them. So the industry was very keen to get support, very keen to change where it could, but didn't want to have solutions imposed on them. They wanted to be very involved in the design of them. And a hospitality charter, for example, might be the first manifestation of that. And Helen sits on that, is likely to be involved in the construction of that.
Yeah, and I think what I'd add to this is that one of the things that we really observe here at the convention, and the reason why we do our work sectorally, is that, you know, sectoral norms grow up within a sector. So work in retail, all the employers look quite similar, or a lot of the employers look quite similar, but that looks quite different to hospitality, which looks quite different to construction. So there's sort of sectoral norms that grow up, even though employment law is consistent across all sectors. And one of the things that we wanted to do was help employers think about why their business model looks the way that it does, why they make the choices that they do, and why similar employers in hospitality are looking are making similar choices to the employer down the road. And I think some of that is actually about the culture that exists within a sector and the discussions that business leaders have amongst themselves about what works and why it works. So what we were actually trying to do as well was give space for discussions about good fair work practice and to profile the good practice that employers are already undertaking in that sector, and to show that actually, yeah, it can be, you know, challenging to pay the real living wage or not use 0 hours contracts, but there are employers who are already doing that and are doing that really, really successfully and are running really strong businesses and actually have very good outcomes as a result of those practices. And that's the kind of conversation that we wanted to help businesses have with each other as well. So some of this was about helping businesses see that actually some of the decisions that they were making on business models did come with penalties for how their business were running, and trying to help them join the dots on some of that. And then them also to see that the it was possible to run it differently and have good outcomes as a result of that.
All right, thanks very much.
Brian Patel, do you wish a supplementary? And then I'm going to bring in Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Can I spin quickly back to just one of the things that said earlier? I think my colleague Lorna actually has discussed about the level of disability unemployment. And one of the things we heard was that the figure's difficult to quantify because we are recognising, you know, disability in different ways, and some of the figures are, for example, skewed because we're recognising disability in people who are already in employment that weren't previously recognised as that. So when you said that Denmark was the sort of benchmark, if you like, they used in disability unemployment in terms of they had a drive to have training opportunities to develop the sort of disability community. Were disabilities uniform across all of those countries, how it was recognised?
Use measures in national statistics. It's the only way in which we can do proper comparability. So we take whatever measure is used within usually the European Labour Force Survey, because we get comparability across countries. So whether or not that measure is wholly accurate or not, it's the same measure that's applied across all of these countries. That's the only way in which we can get data comparability. So that's not problematic. It is problematic because we often don't know, people have to report disabilities in one way or another, and we might not pick up on different experiences for people who become disabled within work versus people who are disabled before they access work, and that's quite tricky. I've done some research in the past on people with epilepsy who have really poor labour market opportunities. But people with epilepsy who were already in work when they developed epilepsy do much better than people who have epilepsy before they access work. So there are important variations in there that your question talks to.
Thank you. Sorry, you wanted to ask something?
On the specific point of Denmark, I think we asked a research institution to do this piece of work, and they did a very good job for us. And they used a figure that was available for the reference year in question. It just so happened that there was, I think, a problem with that figure for Denmark for that year, and it seemed to be outside of the country's normal trend. So when we looked into the figure further, we find that the normal trend for Denmark is more about 18.1 percentage points for so still significantly better than Scotland's position, but not as low as it was. That figure seemed to be a bit of an anomaly within for Denmark's disability employment rate. So that would be one of the things that we do have to take into account when looking at this, is that if they report an odd figure one year, it might be an anomaly in the data rather than a sign of progress. So it is about understanding the trends over time as well.
Okay, so if I could go to the underutilisation of skills quickly, if I could. I wondered whether or not that underutilisation of skills is around that training, is more retraining, because we have a shifting economy within Scotland. So we have some really highly skilled, you know, we're doing one, for example, in the northeast, and we're transitioning to a different economy. And I wonder whether or not support in that area is something that is contributing to that underutilisation of skills. And associated with that, if I could, Professor, you talked about living wage for apprentices. We have fewer apprentices than we require at the moment, and it's a cost implication there. And for everything that I've seen, that a lot of these companies would like to take on more apprentices, but can't afford it. So where does government come into that in terms of ensuring that there are enough apprenticeship places at the right wage structure?
If I can pick up on the apprentices piece first. The question I answered was about pay rates for apprentices and whether or not they get the national living wage and the real living wage, as do 18-year-olds, if that becomes the new norm. I think the challenge we have is that apprentices take lots of shapes and forms. So there are some circumstances in which it is absolutely right to pay apprentices the real living wage. And that is often something that's supported by government policy, including Fair Work First conditionality. There is the opportunity for exemptions, and there are significant numbers of exemptions given for apprentices in terms of Fair Work First conditionality. But there are also lots of good examples, and if I can come back again to construction, there are good examples of collective agreements where apprenticeship pay is very much related to whether or not they are training or performing. And the challenge, the worry that we have around apprenticeship pay is if you're being paid a lower rate, sometimes as low as £4 or £5, but you're delivering the same performance as everybody else. That's clearly not fair. Where in construction the employer and union agreement differentiates between productive time and training time, everybody gains from that and everybody agrees with it. So you can come up with some quite good apprenticeship arrangements that deal with that issue of pay and what the pay should be. The bigger question about the number of apprentices is certainly not something that I have any major competence in, how government funds apprenticeships. But I think that we should certainly be making it possible for employers to take on apprenticeships where they are delivering fair work for those apprentices. I think we have to be very careful when we publicly fund apprenticeships or support for apprenticeships where fair work is not being delivered, because it's not consistent with the policy objective that we've signed up to.
On skills utilisation, my understanding is that, and Tricia might want to come in on this, that Scotland has quite a long-standing issue of skills underutilisation, and therefore I don't think that that's likely to be simply a reflection of a moment of change within the economy.
I think that's correct. I think we should also see skills underutilisation as an opportunity, not a threat. If we have lots of people out there in the economy who think they could be doing more, we have to find ways in which they can have more rewarding work that's better for their employers. So actually, skills underutilisation for me feels like a free opportunity. How do we have the conversations within workplaces that encourages people to do all of their best?
And to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Good morning. Thank you for attending. The underpinning a lot of what we've been discussing thus far is the data and the meaning within that. And the Scottish Government stated that the research you commissioned helped inform its Fair Work Action Plan, brackets, evidence plan. So my first question is, to what extent does that evidence plan provide an effective framework for measuring whether Scotland is on track to be a fair work nation, and if it does, why does it, in terms of data items and the measures, and if it doesn't, where are the gaps? Thank you.
Very closely with the Scottish Government on the Fair Work Evidence Framework. I think it's in all of our interests to be able to understand where we are, where it's possible for us to be, and coming back to our measurement report, how we might learn things that take us there. So we've worked very closely with them. We are, in a sense, prisoners of data. So there are some areas where we have very good data. We tend to have very good data around security issues, labour market hours, participation, contracts, pay. Those tend to be collected very well. We have other areas where we have much, much poorer data. So things like fulfilment, the intrinsic job quality that people have, it's much harder to collect that, and we don't tend to have good national statistics. We have good national statistics, for example, around trade union presence and collective bargaining, but we don't really have much, we don't any longer have good data sets that allow us to see the impact of that. So what's the outcome on the ground of having good, good social dialogue at workplace level? We used to have that through the previous Workplace Employment Relations Survey series, which was representative across the UK and was very helpful, but that's been discontinued since, I think, 2012 or 2014. So we tend not to have that kind of data. So what we're trying to do, I think, alongside the Scottish Government, and Helen might want to come in on some of this also, we're trying to just do the best we can with the data that's there while having constructive conversations with, for example, the ONS around how we improve measures in national data sets.
Okay. Just to follow on, I know you might want to come in, Helen, the survey that you mentioned that's been discontinued, how much appetite do you anticipate from other agencies that are responsible for either undertaking services or indeed the UK government and are responsible for collecting that data? In other words, some of the data you highlight is necessary for us to be able to measure whether or not we're on target for Fair Work Nation. So I suppose I'm exploring appetite from the UK government and also other agencies, and you mentioned ONS, obviously.
There have been, over the last couple of years, some discussions about the areas in which there are gaps in labour market data, and some willingness, I think, both by the Scottish Government and the UK Government for those discussions to try and highlight and expand. So there is an expanded labour force survey. There have been some new questions that we've been collectively involved in having added to the labour force survey. So I think there's an openness to that. There's an inevitable constraint, which is cost. And obviously the fiscal context is not great for some massive data collection exercise. But it will become, over the coming years, it will become important to be able to understand, for example, how some of the new measures for the New Deal for Working People are having an impact. It'll be very difficult to do that without data. We do have organisations like CIPD who provide supplementary data. So they do a Working Lives UK report and a Working Lives Scotland report. And we pick up some information both from those and from the academic community that engages in maybe specific surveys in certain sectors or occupations. So we pick up some, but the gold standard for comparative data has to be national statistics, and therefore, or sort of nationally representative surveys, which the old Workplace Employment Relations Survey was. So in the absence of that, there'll be some questions we can answer and some questions that we can't answer. What I would say, and I think this is important, and it's a bit of a statement against interest because I'm an academic, I like collecting data, surveys are my thing. What is important is quite a lot of the real challenges in Fair Work, we know what they are. We might be able to get better, more granular data, and that might help in some regards. But the big ticket questions we know are there. And I think one of the things that we try to do in our inquiries is to bring people in, not just to agree an evidence base, although that's very, very important. It was very important in hospitality to get everybody to accept that while their business might not be doing those things, the data told us that, for example, hospitality has the lowest median pay of any sector in the UK. So that's part of what we want to do. We want to get the data right and understand the evidence well. But actually, those inquiries are really focused on action. What are the things we can change? What are the things that we know are a challenge that we can try to do differently? Even if we don't get the nitty-gritty of the data absolutely correct, if we really understand the phenomena and the trend, let's get people together in dialogue, convene those people together to be able to deliver on that.
Well, thank you for your last point, and I hear them, those very strongly. Just a last wee question before, and I'll let Helen come in as well, is to what extent is all the data collectors routinely disaggregated by sex? Is that something you see, and indeed all agencies as well, although I fully accept your last comment. So perhaps you could just answer that, and then Helen, if you've got any final considerations.
All national data is disaggregated by all protected characteristics.
Thank you. Helen. Anything to add in any of
that? Nothing to add.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, panel. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Firstly, about your heat map that you produced earlier on the Fair Work Indicators, Helen, you mentioned that 19 had improved and 10 had worsened of the 45 indicators. Can you say, of the 8 comparable countries, was there similar movement in the number of improvements and worsening position, or were their indicators pretty stable? And was there any underlying common reasons for that?
So we don't know the answer to that. Because we have two reports. One is the Scotland measurement framework, which we've trended over time. So we pick up the trend. So when we talk about improving or worsening, we're talking about in a Scottish context. For the other data for the international framework, we look at a time point. So we haven't looked at that.
And trends for the
we don't have the trends.
Can I just add that we are going to refresh this report, however, so in the new year we'll provide an updated version, right, which would be able to tell you how it's moved since this version that you're looking at.
Right, okay. That's very interesting to know. In terms of, this maybe makes my second question a wee bit more awkward, but anyway, on the heat map you indicated the positive performances of Scotland in three different areas. Second place for lower youth employment rate, second place for respect for workers in work ill health, and first place for higher levels of permanent employment. Why is it that Scotland's doing so well in those areas and not in others?
That's a good and rather big question. So the permanent employment one, I think, is interesting because it's, although we've seen a rise in zero-hours contracts, we've also got a lot of people in permanent employment. That tends to be a positive labour market indicator. I don't think I know a single answer to that. I think partly the challenge of measuring Fair Work is because it's multidimensional. So there are lots of different things that we measure, and they may not always be moving in the same direction for a host of different reasons. Those might be separate reasons. Some of them might be connected, and I'll maybe give you an example that might be helpful there. If you, for example, if you take action, for example, on gendered occupational segregation, you may well, and there are actually examples of this in Scotland, you may well promote more women proportionately into higher level occupations, but you may well at the same time increase your gender pay gap because they are promoted into a higher level occupation, probably at the lowest pay of that level, and other people, men, know, disproportionately will be in that level. So you might see indicators that are connected that move in a different direction. And I think what we need to do is to try and see these sorts of indicators in the round. So if there are things that are very clearly worsening, they're a concern. We have some measures that fluctuate, and there will be a natural fluctuation over time. So sometimes they'll be connected, sometimes they'll be disconnected, and they'll be driven by a host of very different determinants.
So, excuse me, you made a number of action points for the Scottish Government, clear targets for 2025, drawing lessons from other countries that are doing well, effectiveness of Fair Work First, childcare policy support and all the rest of it. What was the response from the Scottish Government, and what progress has been made over the last year?
The response has been from the Scottish Government has been very positive, and some of those actions have already started to take place. So we've already there's already some work around looking at active labour market policy in Denmark. There's already some work emerged in relation to childcare. So the measurement report was received constructively by the Scottish Government. They've continued to work with us on some of the areas that we identified as being important. Helen might want to pick up on some other detail around that.
Yes, so we've also begun to do an evaluation of Fair Work First with the Scottish Government. So the Convention's working quite closely with the Government to define that and to look at how that will be taken forward. I think that will be quite a
a large piece of work. But with some of the changes coming from the UK government around the legislative baseline, it is likely that looking at how Fair Work First functions will be something that we'll pick up in quite a lot of detail with the Scottish Government going forward. And we are also in discussion about what is the view going forward. So what can be delivered by 2025? Well, we're nearly there now. So I think that question has maybe moved more on to how are we seeing this over time, and what are the indicators? What progress would we like to make on the indicators over time? And that's the discussion that we're having currently with Scottish Government.
Okay. And some of the other indicators that you wanted some action on was investment in active labour market policies, more conditionality in relation to zero-hour contracts, gender pay gap, collective bargaining, etc. How much is the Scottish Government's hands tied by the fact that employment law is reserved?
Important ways in which the Scottish Government's hand is tied, and we've seen some discussions recently around the way in which procurement guidance has to take into account that the powers over employment law are reserved. So there are some real challenges there, and the Scottish Government has to comply with that. I've now lost the thread of your question.
Just basically trying to understand how much scope there is for the Scottish Government to improve zero-hour contracts, gender pay gap, labour market policies, collective bargaining when employment law is reserved.
Yeah, so clearly effective voice is a mandatory part of Fair Work First. So you have to pay the real living wage and you have to provide opportunities for effective employee voice. So there are opportunities for the Scottish Government to use their significant purchasing power and the public's significant purchasing power to support the kinds of arrangements that we want to see and the kinds of outcomes that we want to see in terms of Fair Work. So I think we have really encouraged and pressurised the Scottish Government to use the levers that they have to the fullest extent of their powers. Sometimes that's conditionality, so it's saying, well, if you apply for government grants or if you contract with the public sector, then you need to do that. And I think that's really important. We should remember that conditionality is applied across lots of government spending, and very significantly when you come to things like welfare spending. When we talk about aspects of active labour market policy, the Scottish Government is responsible for providing employability support. So employability is a really important area for supporting people who are far from the labour market or who are particularly vulnerable in the labour market back into employment. So those employability powers are at the level of the Scottish Government. They are within the powers of the Scottish Parliament. And we've seen an attempt to build in, for example, greater security of employment into things like employability support, so that if people stay and work longer, there's a better payment to the employability provider. But I think what we haven't seen is that impact on things like pay rates or indeed opportunities for progression within jobs that come through employability support. So again, we're really urging the Scottish Government to say, use those powers really creatively. You are responsible for employability support. We know that active labour market policy does work. There's lots of good evidence. So what are the ways in which you can take employers, providers and government working together to make sure that you can use that leverage to produce a very good Fair Work outcome? And that's been received, that's been well received, I think, so far.
And you're right, it would be it's an area that the Scottish Government can act to an extent, but it would be an awful lot easier if it had the powers of legislate and employment law to address these issues.
Well yeah, more powers allow you to have more scope.
Exactly.
It's also the case that a lot of what happens in that space is about working with providers to help support and educate them about why it's really important to deliver Fair Work. So there's a lot that can be done legislatively. There's a lot that can be done through funding conditionality. There's also a really important role that government plays in a devolved context about encouraging people to... I think we have a very strong narrative for Fair Work now in Scotland. I think it's something that's being picked up by other parts of the UK and other countries. It's looked upon very positively that we've been creative with the powers that we have, albeit that those powers are constrained. So government is often the convener of important stakeholders in the economy. They are in the room. They often have a coordinating role in that room. So again, we've had some recent research around what are the levers for Fair Work, how do we best leverage it. Employment law is a really important part of that. Spending is a really important part. But so are the kinds of relationships that government engage in with business and industry more broadly. And a good example of that would be, for example, the industry leadership groups. So the industry leadership groups are a coming together with policymakers, supported by policymakers, although in not a necessarily very obvious way, to talk about industry challenges. I don't think they are have been used, and we've said so in a recent report, as effective a vehicle for creating dialogue at an industry or sectoral level as they might be. And the extent to which they've engaged with Fair Work is very, very variable. So the retail ILG has had a subgroup on Fair Work with challenging progress. The hospitality ILG is now keen to engage further with Fair Work. But there will be lots of industry leadership groups in Scotland that won't really be discussing Fair Work at all. Indeed, I attended their first symposium, which they kindly invited me to last week. A lot of the industry leadership groups will talk about the importance of people, but not necessarily engage very constructively with an explicit Fair Work agenda. So that's another role for government, which is to use their convening power and their influence in those spaces to improve the dialogue around Fair Work and support people to be able to engage with it better.
OK, thanks very much.
Thank you. Just before I bring in Willie Coffey, the witnesses will know that the committee is working on its budget pre-budget letter to the Scottish Government, and we have in recent years seen cuts to the employability budget. Obviously, we're in difficult financial times, but is that an area where you would like to see the government consider reversing some of the cuts that we made to that sector? When you talk about active labour market policies, it seems to be a key feature of if we're going to make the kind of changes through labour market policies, employability support is a big part of that.
I think investment in active labour market policy is an investment. It accrues benefits in the future. It is really challenging if we start to cut employability support. One of the big challenges that we have at the moment in the Scottish and UK economy is economic inactivity. One of the key areas in which we might drive growth is having more people participate in the labour market. So it may be a kind of short-term response to cut those budgets, but those budgets are really important, as we've said in the report, to trying to support people back into work. And I think that's not, it's not the only place in which we have challenges. I am very mindful of the real difficulties of the current fiscal position, but there are some areas where, without at least some level of investment, it will be difficult to shift the dial on Fair Work. An obvious example of that would be social care. We have tried to push the recommendations of our social care inquiry from a few years ago. It's very difficult to institute new practices and new arrangements on an entirely cost-neutral basis, and therefore moving towards sectoral bargaining and social care hits lots of challenges and obstacles, but one of those challenges is how do you fund that move, for example, if that means equalising some terms and conditions across workers who are, whoever employs them, almost entirely paid for by the public sector. So we are aware of those real challenges, but I think that the Convention's view is some of these areas are really important investments for the future and we need to think very seriously about them.
I'm going to touch on, you mentioned the public sector. When Gordon MacDonald was asking about permanent employment rates, Scotland does have quite a high percentage of the labour market who are employed by the public sector. I don't know if that's the same in the comparator countries and whether that's a feature of, does that influence some of our indicators that we do have quite a high percentage of people working in the public sector or for good or not so good? Or
I'm quite intrigued by this, partly because at the ILG symposium last week, Graham Roy, the chair of the Fiscal Commission, spoke and was very clear that 80% of Scotland's employment is provided by the private sector. So there was certainly some suggestion during that event by an MP, I think, that we were a public sector economy that slightly confused me. Yes, we have a slightly bigger public sector than England, but not than Wales or Ireland. But the vast majority of our employment is provided by the private sector, and therefore working with the private sector to deliver Fair Work is, as we've always argued, crucially important.
Well, thank you. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you. I'd like to ask a few questions about employers and staff attitude to these kinds of issues, if I may. Firstly, are you getting a sense, or did the researchers get a sense, that Scottish employers are engaging with this principle of fair work much more these days? Is it accelerating? Is there quite a broad participation? Would you say, did the researchers ask that?
We don't know. It's not. There's no way in which we can gauge how many employers are exposed to discussions around fair work. A lot of that will be to do with networks. So a lot of our engagement over the years has been to identify key organisations that we might work with, employers' organisations, trade bodies, professional organisations, regulatory organisations, so try and have those conversations. And I think those conversations are now really, really well embedded in Scotland. So it doesn't really matter what sector you're looking at, you will come across not just employers but other stakeholders who know about fair work. But we don't really have a sense about, in the general population, how well is it understood. I would say in the work that I do, I'm an academic, I spend a lot of time working with industry, that the ideas are not just known, but they are well received. Helen, do you want to maybe say anything?
I think where employers interact with the state, where they receive either public funding or are part of a procurement contract, I think they're more aware of fair work because of the conditionality that goes into it. I think that has been a big driving force for the agenda, actually.
But is that we have to follow these principles, or we want to follow these principles? What's the sense of employers' participation in this? Do they feel as though they've been dragged into it, or willingly engaging with it? I suppose I'm trying to get at that. Do we know?
I think for both for policymakers and indeed for us and for researchers, we tend not to have conversations with employers who say we'd really rather not do any of these things. More often, much, much more often, there's a willingness to do it, but a discussion of the constraints and challenges that they face and the things that stand as obstacles to them engaging in fair work. So there's lots of research across different parts of Scotland about what people, what employers themselves and managers think about fair work, and it tends to be pretty positive. Nobody tends to tell us. If there are people who think that, they tend not to have that discussion with us or indeed with the research community, because they tend to want to do these things but feel constrained. So now, there is a swathe of employers in Scotland who don't connect, as Helen has said, with government because they access funds and they're not members of employers' organisations and they don't tend to be active in trade bodies. So there is a significant section of employers for whom none of us have a real idea about what they know and what they think. And neither do, this conversation we had at the hospitality inquiry launch, neither do the employers' organisations themselves know what these employers think. So, yeah, there's a bit of a black hole somewhere. But we don't tend to see outright opposition to the idea of fair work or the kinds of practices associated with it.
My question is, what kind of lead us to thinking about that? How do we encourage more employers to participate in this whole principle of fair work, which is a great thing, I'm sure colleagues agree. But could I just ask a couple of questions more about the survey itself? And do we know if the questions that were asked that led to these results in Scotland relative position and so on were aimed at staff within their employee or the employers as well? And how do we know whose perspective it is we're seeing here in this data?
So these are largely national statistics. They're largely reported by employers.
Is it staff who are saying what they're saying, or is it the employers saying this about themselves?
It's mainly employer data.
Right.
So things like the annual survey of hours and earnings is something that's taken from PAYE records. So some of these are not. That report that that ALMA produced is not a single survey. It's an aggregation of lots of different national statistics with the addition of some other surveys like CIPD where we've been able to use it and we've thought it was robust enough. And for the most part, some parts of those will come from the Labour Force survey. Some parts of that will be replied to by individuals. And some parts of this data will have been delivered by employers. So it's a mixture across the different types of data in the report.
one of the key principles is about respect in the workplace. And I'm looking at the aggregate table that's in the papers that we have. It's in your report. It seems to break it down in terms of two categories, like workplace non-fatal injuries and work-related ill health and disease. But the key principles talk about things like well-being and dignified treatment. And so I'm curious about how do we measure that? And I would suggest to you that you can only measure that by asking staff what they think. Are they treated with respect in their job? So is that captured in this data, do you think?
So when, if we hark back to the Fair Work framework, when we talk about respect as a dimension of Fair Work, we talk about a really basic thing, which we talked about 9 years, 8 or 9 years ago. You should be safe and well at work. So the very respect for your health and safety, respect for your well-being, but we're also really interested in respect for your contribution, respect for your work-life balance, interpersonal respect in terms of how people are treated, respect for your potentially protected characteristics. So it comes back to what I think one of the members mentioned earlier about areas where we have data and areas where we don't. So we don't tend to have data around things like, we don't have very good data in the UK or in Scotland around things like bullying and harassment. We tend to have specific surveys for example, for a sector, so there's one in hospitality, but we don't tend to have national data that would allow us to talk about that. So you're absolutely correct. There are really important elements of respect that aren't captured in reports like this, but those parts of respect are really important. I always take the opportunity to quote my mother at this point, respect costs nothing. So when we talk about Fair Work interventions, which don't necessarily come up against the constraint of cost or fiscal restraint, then respect is one of those areas. So how people are treated at work, whether or not things are discussed with them, whether or not they are listened to, whether or not employers are flexible to the demands of complex family lives, all of those things are important parts of Fair Work, really important to employees, actually massively beneficial to employers where you can deliver that, but we don't pick them up on surveys and we can't really measure them very well.
You did capture the fact, though, that stress-related absence has more than doubled, and that's a statutory indicator to be reported, I understand it. So at least you've got that. Just my final question, convener, around the area of kind of widening this out. Is there a sense that employers might be interested in establishing some kind of Fair Work accreditation scheme, either by self-assessment or otherwise, so that they could show their staff and employees who may wish to work for them that they are a Fair Work employer? Would that be something worth aiming towards and to reach out to that wider sector of employers that we were talking about a wee minute ago? Would that be something that you'd like?
I think you wanted to come in the respect one, and I'll answer on that accreditation point.
Sorry, just very briefly, in the respect indicators in the actual Fair Work framework, where there's slightly more, we did have three on discrimination, harassment and bullying. However, those indicators had to come from the CIPD Work and Life survey because there were no national statistics on this point. So I think it just emphasises what Tricia was discussing earlier about the gaps in the data and how we've had to plug those with information we can use.
The principles talk about things like dignified treatment and well-being, but if it uses these in the framework, it seems to me that they should try to assess it and ask staff what they think about that to gather that data. Otherwise, what's the point of having it in the key principles in the first place?
Well yes, you could only do that by asking staff themselves. Yep. But what we're saying is there's no national source of that data.
Okay.
So there are discrete studies that look at that in some contexts, okay, but there's no national source of that.
Okay,
so one of the things,
the wider position of maybe an accreditation framework, some kind of public-facing framework.
We think long and hard about the idea of what might help drive and embed and maintain Fair Work in Scotland. We've done some work recently looking at accreditation. One of the things which employers tell us is that they feel that they face a lot of demands. To deliver on net zero commitments, to deliver on community benefit, to deliver on equality and diversity. And so I'm not sure that there's always an appetite for an additional accreditation. But I think what sways me in away from being interested in Fair Work accreditation is if you make accreditation really robust, i.e. you verify whether or not it's delivered, then it becomes both expensive and it is adhered to by a much smaller group of employers. If you make it very light touch, then its effect tends to be less. So there's a bit of a choice when it comes to accreditation. People in the room will be aware of, you know, ISO 9000 accreditation, the most prominent accreditation on the planet. It costs a lot. It cost a lot to set up. It was underwritten by the EU, by global governments. So in that sense, unless you're going to invest a huge amount of money in making accreditation really robust and doing it over time, then you're likely to get a kind of poorer version that's midway. The closest example I can give you is the Labour government, the new Labour government some decades ago invested a lot of money in IIP accreditation, and employers did take up that accreditation process and many found it to be helpful. But it was a lot of money. It was upwards of £35 million, which I'm not sure anybody's willing to spend at the moment. And the evidence suggests that IIP often accredited businesses who were doing it rather than businesses on a journey towards doing it. And so it's not clear to me that the mechanism of accreditation wouldn't do anything other than signify the employers who are there and how would we test that. But part of what I think we really need to do is to learn from the employers that are doing really well, but actually work with the employers who would like to be there, but just see obstacles in their way and think about how we deal with those obstacles. So it's partly, the accreditation issue is really about what's your target audience? Is it, and I'm sure you don't mean it, like, is it a reward for the people currently doing well? Which partly conditionality is. Fair Work First conditionality is, in a sense, that reward. Or is it a mechanism to get more employers to engage in it? And I think it's probably unlikely to do. Sorry, I think we're really interested in the levers we can use that do the latter. How do we make a bigger group of employers that have this conversation, that engage with us and with policymakers in this regard, so that that momentum for Fair Work becomes something that's really positively associated with operating in the Scottish economy?
Thanks very much for that.
Brian Foothill, do you wish a supplementary in this area?
I'll bring in
Kevin Stewart and thank Kevin Stewart for his patience this morning.
Just around, I mean, every business I've ever been involved in, just every business I've ever spoken to recognises that the greatest resource is the people that work for them and work within the business. If we introduce, which I think everybody's in agreement with, a real living wage, there's consequent knock-ons with other salaries above that as well to maintain that gap. There are those businesses on the who would love to be doing paying a living wage who are, you know, margins are really small, and the wage bill is the greatest bill that they have, and in introducing a living wage would you know cause real problems. So, you know, and I'm thinking in terms of, for example, in hospitality, we've talked to, you know, Murdoch Place have talked about hospitality. There are many hospitality offerings now that close. They have periods of the year that they close, which in turn, you know, would drive 0 hours contracts, for example, because they're shut for 2 or 3 months of the year. And I'm thinking very much around the sort of nursing homes as well. There's a lot of nursing homes closed when the living wage was introduced without the compensatory pay from the public sector. So how do we, I suppose it's government intervention. It's not just about the desire to pay the living wage. It's how do we make it affordable to pay the living wage? You know, what government intervention should we have at that point?
So I think that, I'll bring Helen in a second, but I think that answer is different across contexts. So I think there are issues around things like funding social care, which are really challenging. Much of that is delivered through the third sector and the private sector. We've done some research in third sector organisations where it's very clear that if you pay the real living wage, it might impact on your differentials. So therefore, In some of these contexts, it's difficult to get people to take team leader opportunities because the difference in pay is quite small for the responsibility that comes on. I think that was very clear in hospitality. managers' fair work experience was not considered to be good, and people didn't want to become managers, even though we think that progression is a good part of fair work, because they could see lots of stress and responsibility, but an awful lot of unpaid hours. So there are different responses to that, I think, in different contexts. One is about business models. So for the many businesses who say, I'm really struggling to keep up with my pay bill, there are also businesses whose business model is about specifically keeping fair work down in order to improve profitability. And those are a different set of businesses. It's interesting if you look at hospitality. If you look globally at the research, luxury hotels don't tend to do that much better than other hospitality, than poorer quality hotels. That's a decision. That's a business decision. So that's one part of it. We do have businesses that make decisions to not deliver fair work because it's profitable. And I think we really need to be able to deter that form of business behaviour, because the costs of that fall on everybody else. They fall on us in terms of child poverty. They fall on us in terms of health consequences. So not every business model should be supported, I think, is very clear, because it won't deliver fair work and it'll impose those significant externalities. Where it becomes a really tricky discussion is in the things that are publicly funded. So, for example, social care being the best example, and not just a challenge in Scotland, but in the UK and more widely. It's a political decision to invest in the sorts of money required to deliver social care that does not impose an unfair burden on largely low-qualified, middle-aged women workers, because that's what that sector looks like. And taking a decision that says, well, it's too costly, is about saying we will build a system of social care that is on the back of those workers. And that's really problematic. But that's a political decision, and that's for people who are elected to make those decisions and not me. When it comes to private sector businesses, I think that we need to support those businesses that want to do better. I think we need to deter those businesses for whom it is low pay is a route to improved profitability rather than a means of survival.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. There has been a lot of talk today around about pay, and rightly so. The survey looks a lot about pay and some associated scenarios like health and safety and supporting families, including childcare and that. Not so much of an emphasis in the survey on conditions and things associated with pay, shall we say. So can I ask, in terms of comparisons, has any work been done to look at the likes of maternity pay or the lack of it in some cases, sick pay or the lack of it in some cases, and how do we compare with others, including the likes of Denmark, who, as you rightly say, Professor Finlay, works in that social market economy basis rather than the liberal market economy.
Okay, so we haven't done that work and it's not part of the report. I completely agree with you that pay is not the only part of your reward from work, and that those issues around maternity pay, paternity pay, sick pay became a really important interest and concern during the pandemic. But also things like pensions. What happens with pensions? Because we know that not accessing pension provision when you're in work has huge consequences when you're no longer in work. So we don't have a report that's looked at that. We do know from other evidence that in the social market economies, particularly the Nordics, but also things like Netherlands or the Germany, we do see better provision around some of these, not all, but some of these benefits. What we do know is that there tends to be a very strong association between what you're paid and your non-pay benefits. So if you're well paid, you tend to have very good non-pay benefits as a package. And if you're less well paid, you tend to have much poorer non-pay benefits. It's not a clear causation, but it's very, very close. So we use pay as a proxy because that's what we have data on and that's what we've collected in these national statistics. But I think we can assume that where low pay sits, we will also see poorer aspects of terms and conditions. That tends to be the case outside of, as you rightly point out, the statutory provision. And there are some attempts in the sort of international research to try and think about what employers provide and what's provided by the state, but that's quite a complex thing to measure. So where the state provides it, then obviously it's less of an issue and isn't going to come up in these sorts of measures.
I think we would probably agree that fair work is more than just fair pay, and that these conditions are extremely important, particularly for women. And you said that you know, we have been creative with the powers that we have here in Scotland. Do you think that legislation, regulation in these areas need to be toughened up to make sure that women are treated fairly when it comes to maternity pay, men as well in terms of paternity pay, and that folk have equal access to decent sick pay?
If we look at maternity and paternity pay, the regulatory framework is at the very least clear. There is a big challenge around enforcement. So how do we know whether or not people are accessing the rights that they have? So that's a slightly different question, because at one level we can say, is the level of that correct? And that's again a political and resource decision. Is the level of, for example, maternity pay or paternity pay, or the level of leave, is the statutory underpinning of that right? And it's less than in other countries and it's more than in some. So that's one question. The other really important question for me is, where you have those rights, are you able to enforce them? Are you able to rely on them? How many people don't get access to what they should get, whether that's in terms of the minimum wage, and we see a report of that from the HMRC every year, whether or not that's in terms of how they are treated during pregnancy or maternity leave, and what kind of access to those provisions that they get. So in that sense, the availability of a right really does rely on the ability to enforce that right. Sick pay, we don't really have anything other in a statutory sense in the UK than statutory sick pay, which I think I could have got this wrong, but maybe £72 a week. Not many people are going to be living on £72 a week if they don't have any other occupational sick pay. So that is a really important part of supporting people when they are unwell. But actually, for most people, it's the occupational benefit which is really important. And we don't have any data set on what occupational sick pay looks like across organisations.
Thank you for that. And I think it was important, convener, to go over some of those conditions issues, particularly given some of the commentary that has been made this week around about maternity pay from certain quarters. I want to change tack just a little bit. And we talked about conditionality, and that can work to a degree, I think we would all agree. We haven't talked a huge amount about sectoral bargaining and how it can play a part. I'm going to probably ask a devil's advocate question here. Around about sectoral bargaining. And let's take the example of social care, which I think we're all pretty well aware of. If we look at trade union membership in social care, the bulk of the trade union membership exists in the public sector, in local government, not so much in the private and third sector. Do you think that trade unions should have a greater role in persuading and trying to increase membership in the third sector, the private sector, in that sphere, as well as others, in order that we can get the real balance when it comes to sectoral bargaining?
The proposals in the New Deal for Working People are, and indeed in the current discussions in Scotland around the establishment of sectoral bargaining for social care, both recognise that a right of access is really important. So trade unions, I am sure, want to increase their membership as much as possible. But sometimes that's to do with their own capacity constraints that organisations or individuals aren't contacted. But sometimes it's to do with a right of access. So part of what I think we need to underpin effective trade union voice, which again on every indicator shows us a whole host of positive outcomes across the globe. Part of what we need to do is to underpin that right of access. How do trade unions access workers and be able to have the conversations such that individuals can make a free choice as to whether or not they wish to be members or otherwise? And that looks like it's something that will be at least part of the New Deal for Working People, and it is something which is part of the current conversation of the Social Care Fair Work Implementation Group. So that is important. If I come back to my earlier discussion about dialogue, effective dialogue requires you to have parties to participate in the dialogue. So the real challenges are in sectors where employers have poor collective voice and workers have poor collective voice, because we simply don't have the fora and the process through which people can engage in improving a whole host of different things, including fair work. So the presence or otherwise of those collective groups, and I include employers and trade unions in that, allows you to then do what I think we do very well in the convention, which is to convene people around a table and work out what are the intractable challenges, what can we try and fix, and what do we have to be supported to fix. Without a voice in the room, without a voice that has some collective representation, it's really difficult to do that. And so hopefully the right of access will underpin some of that. Hopefully some of the support for sectoral bargaining at a UK level, as well as indeed at a Scottish level for social care, will allow those sorts of tricky and challenging but ultimately productive discussions and dialogue to take place.
Thank you for that. You've talked a fair bit there about effective voice and in terms of the Fair Work agenda. That's spoken about a great deal. Mainly, we talk about that from a trade union and worker perspective in the main. But you, again, mentioned earlier around about the best models of bringing workers, unions, employers, government together. Denmark was your example. That works well. Do you think that here, do we have a job of work to do with many employers to try and get to see sectoral bargaining as a positive rather than a negative, as some see it as?
Yes, I think there is a significant job of work to do. If we look back in time in UK history, then sectoral bargaining was a feature. It was something that employers benefited from, as well as employees and trade unions, and people accepted that that was the case, and therefore that's why they engaged in that sort of activity. We've departed quite a lot from that, not everywhere, but we've departed quite a lot from that over recent decades, and I think that conversation about the potential benefits of sectoral arrangements is one that needs to be supported, because for some employers it won't be anything that they've been exposed to. And for some managers, it won't be anything that they've been exposed to. And I think sometimes the kind of idea is that if you don't know what it is, you would be concerned about it. Some of the most innovative, productive and successful businesses that I've ever worked with in Scotland have really strong structures of collective representation and voice. And they use those structures to great effect to deal with the myriad of challenges that they face. So collective voice is really important. We stress the importance of voice not just because it's good for individuals, which it is. There's a plethora of evidence that tells us that. But we stress it because it's also good for businesses. It does negative things. It eliminates the sort of risks that you might be exposed to and liabilities. But it also does really positive things around allowing you to meet challenges which you face. So voice is a good thing in lots of... And developing capability for voice. Voice is a skill. Developing capability and capacity. And I do have a huge amount of sympathy with employers' organisations, particularly in Scotland, which are relatively under-resourced. They are relatively small organisations dealing with lots of different agendas, including policy agendas. So there is an issue of capacity there. And facilitating that effective voice from both the employer and the employee community, from trade unions themselves, that's the key to a better path towards better social dialogue.
I have one very brief question, or I'll be as brief as I can, and that's around about the disability pay gap and the measures around about that across the comparator countries as well. Is there a breakdown in terms of disability to take account of neurodiverse folk? Do we have separate figures looking at neurodivergence in any of this? And is that something that you think we should be looking at in future?
If I look specifically at the UK data, so the UK data does allow you to understand broad groups of a disability. I'm not absolutely sure that it includes neurodiversity. It certainly includes learning disability. And we actually, what we see from the data is people with learning disability have the poorest employment rates. And as I said earlier, people with epilepsy have very, very poor employment rates, which is not especially consistent with the nature of their condition always. So we know we do, but it is broken down. I can't say whether or not it includes neurodiverse. But we do know that the experience of disability is very different in terms of the labour market, depending on what the nature of your specific disability is. And actually, sometimes people have multiple disabilities, which are particularly challenging in terms of labour market participation.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Just to close, a couple of questions. We do have about 18 months, some 18 months left of this Parliament. Are there areas where you think the committee should be focused? And is there areas in your own work that we can maybe work together on, or that we can anticipate you'll be publishing more reports on?
I suppose we've got a programme of work going forward, so we're very interested in following up on the sort of areas that we've looked at that we think are really challenging. We do want to revisit the hospitality sector a bit later on. We're really interested in trying to make some improvement there. I think the issue around awareness and engaging of employers is really important. I think I have a particular bugbear about the ILGs. I think that they're a mechanism that could be much better. They could be a better place to be having fair work discussions, and I would like to see that more discussed. I do sometimes feel a little bit concerned as the chair of the convention that when we talk about fair work, it's very much suited to context, so it's fine to talk to the STUC about fair work, but not necessarily to industry leaders or to employers, organisations or conferences and so forth. I think we have to be having a really positive dialogue about fair work for the future. Fair work is how we will deal with not just a whole host of demographic challenges that faces Scotland in terms of economic activity and labour force participation, but it's also how we'll deal with challenges around AI and technology, how we'll deal with issues around net zero and sustainability. And quite a lot of the work we've done has shown that we won't deliver on some of those things that are really important unless we can get the fair work aspect of it right. So some of the work around just transition and how we move towards that in a way that delivers fair work while we face quite difficult things around good quality jobs in fossil fuel sectors. Those are really problematic. But some of those areas, I think, would be helped in general terms by a positive narrative around how what happens in our workplaces is really, really important, not just to our economy, but to the well-being of our society, to the lives we lead, to our health, to how our families operate, to whether or not we can participate in our communities. And so I have a very expansive idea about fair work. Most of us spend most of our time outside of sleeping at work. And in actual fact, what happens there is really crucially important, not just to our economy, which of course is very important, but to our society as a whole. And I think there's a place for a very, very positive discussion of where we've come from and indeed where we might go.
Thank you. And I understand there's a new memorandum of understanding between the Convention and the Scottish Government. Do you want to say a bit about the purpose of that and what you're hoping that will achieve?
It was basically to strengthen the governance of the Convention and to make sure that the role of the Convention and the role of ministers was clear and that there were clear working arrangements between the two organisations.
Okay. OK, thank you. That brings us to the end of today's session. Thank you both for giving evidence this morning, and I suspend the meeting and move into private session.